And finding a job in the U.S. continues to be a struggle for many Americans now, 6 years after the economic downturn of 2008. The last year has seen a very slow but steady uptick in employment rates. But when you break down by numbers in race, unemployment rates across America show a huge race and gender disparity. Now, according to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, as of August, African Americans have the highest unemployment rates in the U.S. at 11.4%, nearly double that of whites, who are at 5.3%. Latinos fall right in the middle there at 7.5%, while Asian Americans have the lowest unemployment rate at just 4.5%. Now, unemployment in America as a whole is hovering at about 6.1%, the lowest, though, since before the crash. Meanwhile, statistics show that the group hit hardest by unemployment are African American women, whose rates have remained stagnant at 10.6%. And earlier, I was joined by Max Wolf, the chief economist at Manhattan Venture Partners, to discuss all of these numbers.
Clearly, what we're seeing in a persistent pattern of higher African-American unemployment is the numeric expression of structural bias or discrimination against African-Americans in the labor force. And I think the other thing we're seeing here, the two things we're seeing, are that African-Americans tend to be clustered in areas with limited access to public transit and clustered in areas with higher unemployment. And one of the ironies and unfortunate truths of America is if you don't have very much money, you can't move from where you're stuck, where there probably aren't very many jobs, to where you want to end up, where there are a lot of jobs. And sometimes that involves going from the urban core with higher poverty rates and a larger African American community into the periphery, the suburbs, the emerging cities, where you do tend to see a more white demographic.
Now, do you think this is more of a question of just a simple lack of jobs, or is it a lack of access to education, what would you pinpoint as one of the causal things?
So it's a great question, but unfortunately it's a question good enough that the question will be better than any answer I can give you in the time that we have. I mean, so the quick and dirty answer is C, all of the above. So it's partly an education story, but it's also a story of a few things. There aren't enough jobs, which is why we have persistently higher unemployment across category here, and black and white unemployment do tend to rise and fall together. But the old truth of the civil rights movement, that the African-American community tends to be the last hired and the first fired, is actually proven out by these statistics. So if you face discrimination and if you're in a weak labor market, then you already have a point against you, the discrimination, the structural bias, and there are more people looking for jobs than jobs, so your discrimination will be more painful because the employers literally have their choice of folks really desperate for work.
Now, as I mentioned just a moment ago, the unemployment rate amongst black women has remained stagnant at 10.6%. Why do you think things aren't improving for this segment?
Well, I mean, part of the story here is that there's a lot of African Americans and African American females in public sector employment and in clerical work, and automation and the wholesale decimation of public sector employment has hit very, very hard in the African American community because states, municipalities, and localities have tried, sometimes under court order and sometimes by political will, to hire a demographic that represents the population. They tend to hire more African Americans, and when you have huge net job cuts year in and year out, as we have for 5 years now in the public sector, it will fall unduly hard on both African American shoulders and African American female shoulders. And that is part of what you're pointing out in that uptick in African American female unemployment.
Now, I'm glad that you mentioned particularly clerical work, because the National Women's Law Center did a study across various demographics, and it revealed that the problem is not necessarily one of education. Rather, it showed that black women disproportionately held jobs within the public sector more than any other demographic in the public sector jobs. So does this mean that jobs in the private sector are not really adopting the motto of equal opportunity employer?
Yeah, so I mean, there are some folks in the private sector. Obviously, it's a very diverse set, the private sector. But generally speaking, the public sector is accountable and has official policy commitment to hiring people of color and women of color, the way that very few private sector institutions do. Therefore, as you see the private sector rise, the public sector shrink, and as you see the decimation of American unions, you see the traditional hirers of African-American women shrinking while the rest of the economy grows, and so you'll get a disproportional concentration of suffering among African-American and female African-American people who are looking for jobs.
Now, I want to include Latinos to this question here. Now, recently, I'm sure you've heard of the story of a man named Jose, who was applying to just hundreds of jobs day in and day out with his name Jose. He changed his name to Joe on his CV, and then suddenly he received a whole bunch of job offers. Now, he's certainly not the only person that's reported discrimination based on their names. Now, how extensive do you think that racial profiling might play into the HR department?
Well, there's clearly an issue here. We know it. We know it's persistent. We know it's a huge problem. For what it's worth, that is illegal, by the way, under equal employment opportunity to do that. On the other hand, I might not be the best person to ask because, as your viewers have no doubt been smart enough to detect, I am not readily identified, generally speaking, as a person of color.
And now, well, does the way the BLS then arrive at these overall jobs numbers, do you feel that the way they arrive at these numbers truly reflect the real unemployment rate?
No. So, I mean, the U3, the broad unemployment measure that we tend to be usually referring to and that we're largely talking about with each other today, is more or less likely to systematically underreport unemployment writ large for any group, and probably particularly for people of color, in part because what happens when people can't get jobs, they become discouraged, they stop looking, and then the way the BLS calculates unemployment, we don't count them as unemployed. So generally speaking, the BLS significantly undercounts unemployment, and probably more significantly undercounts unemployment in communities of color as against the mainstream white population.
And now, what would you say can be done to help balance out these numbers? Is it a larger question of legislation, or is it an even larger question of a sociological or philosophical solution to this?
So the two big things that we need to do and that we know work in this space are, we simply need more jobs for everybody, whatever their race, whatever their gender. More opportunity is better for everybody, and it prevents people from fighting for each other for the lifeboats when there aren't enough lifeboats for the passengers on the ship of the U.S. economy. That's the big solution. The other really big solution is to make sure that we definitely and stridently enforce anti-discrimination practices, and that we pay special attention to making sure that folks are getting the jobs based on their qualifications and their ability to do those jobs, not based on the similarity between their last name and the last names of the folks doing the hiring.
All right, we're going to leave that right there. Max, it was really good to see you again. Thanks. That was Max Wolf, chief economist at Manhattan Venture Partners.